me a drink. How many stories begin with lines like that? Or a man walked into a bar? What can be more basic than the need to quench thirst? But we have two stories today from the Bible that talk about the quenching of thirst. The first is that of Moses and the Israelites wandering in the desert in search of the promised land. The second is the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well, and she is in search of eternal life. In both stories, God is using something ordinary and commonplace, water and thirst, to take humans out of the ordinary and commonplace and into an encounter with God's very self. Maybe we need a little biblical history to understand the context of these stories. So Exodus, I am sure you know, is the big story, the defining story of what it means to be the Jews, the chosen people of God. They are trapped in slavery in Egypt. God hears their cries and empowers the reluctant Moses to be their leader. God gives Moses powers that border on the magical as part of getting the Israelites to escape from Egypt across the Nile. At first, they are happy and relieved to be going someplace better than slavery in Egypt. But after years in the desert wilderness, they complain. They complain a lot. And Moses complains to God. What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me. God helps Moses perform another trick, and behold, God does provide, despite the whining and complaining. The people have water to drink as a sign that God is still with them, no matter how far off the promised land may be. One always wonders if the people really get it. But if the people in the Hebrew Bible are wavering and at times faithless, God, the story reminds us, is always constant. Now, flash forward a few hundred years to the 8th century BC, the time of the exile of the Jews to Babylon. This was the event of the big P prophets, like Isaiah and Jeremiah, when they interpreted God's punishment on the Jews for their faithless behavior. Most Jews were captured by the Assyrians and sent away to Babylon. The people of Samaria were left behind. And over the centuries, they intermarried with pagans and grew very apart from who were their fellow Jews. They only believed the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, the book of Moses. Only that was their scripture. They did not worship in Jerusalem. They did not follow the writings of the prophets. For John the Evangelist, in today's gospel, to say, Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans, well, that was an understatement. They shared hardly anything. So can we not today imagine seemingly intractable conflicts between groups of people who think they share nothing? Between today's Israelis and Palestinians, between Shiites and Sunnis, between any two groups whose ancient identities separate them, despite their 21st century need to find some way to live together. One almost begins to believe the drive for war and conflict is as strong in the human being as the drive to quench human thirst. Yet when God enters the equation, things begin to change. Listen to this saying by a Sufi mystic. Not only the thirsty seek water, the water as well seeks the thirsty. When God hears the people's cries in Egypt and in the desert, God goes to them. Water, deliverance, salvation, manna in the wilderness. The water as well seeks the thirsty. When Jesus meets the Samaritan with all of her baggage, the Samaritan woman at the well, the whole separated history of the Jews and the Samaritans is encapsulated in their encounter. He speaks to their longing as a people of God for a Messiah. He speaks to the common connection with Jacob, their common ancestor. He speaks to the woman's own personal desert of her own life. He enables her to give voice to her longings, to have her own thirst quenched, to be known for her deepest self. Jesus says, "Give me a drink." But it is the woman who now drinks deeply from a source of water that will never end. If Jesus, the thirsty, seeks a drink of water, it is Jesus, the living water, who comes to quench her thirst. In the Gospel of John, this unnamed woman is the first evangelist. She is the first to hear this good news and runs to tell her friends to come and talk to Jesus themselves. He told me everything I have ever done. But don't believe only me, she says. Come and see for yourselves. You can see the disciples being baffled by this encounter between Jesus and this strange woman. But Jesus answers with a metaphor for evangelism. See how the fields are ripe for the harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice. The good news goes from the particular to the universal, from the Jews through the Samaritans to the whole world. This is not just ordinary water, but living water. Not the water of your slavery in Egypt, but water that will lead you to the promised land. Not only the thirsty seek water, the water as well seeks the thirsty. So think of your own desert. Think of the thirsts you long to quench. We may live in a place where there is plenty of water and food and everything else. Perhaps we have so much stuff that it is like we are living in a desert. We are trying to quench the thirst with anything at hand. But if God is that living water, it is good to remember that God is seeking us as much as we seek God. God draws us to the promised land, to the well of Jacob. Give me a drink, God says, and it is we who will never be thirsty.